again, thank everybody for hanging out here in the afternoon. I've always thought Dave Eck was cool. Debbie got up and spoke. She's my wife. We've been teaching together for a little bit. And really, all I learned about Dave Eck when she was teaching was that whenever she was late getting home, I said, what are you doing? She goes, they're pouring gels. How long can gels take to pour? It took me forever to realize, you know, what was going on. But I think what's special about Dave Eck, it's the only organization that I know of that has gone out of its way to take a class that's not traditionally in the biochem physics sequencing and try to intentionally think about how to align with NGSS. There are other classes, like most schools have anatomy, physiology, others have similar subjects that may not be in that traditional sequence, and they really haven't, to the extent that Dave Eck has, reached out and thought about how can we make what we do relevant in the era of NGSS. So super kudos to them for doing that. I'm the coordinator for science at the Silver Mountain Unified School District. I'm also on the NGSS state reading team. So hopefully you're familiar with the California framework. We won't have a chance to talk too much about. Let me ask you this. How many of you are familiar with the California framework? Good. Okay. So anybody know the status of the California framework right now? Like today? It is? It's not. It's finished. Yes, we're done. It is back in committee. So it had been out, it had been released earlier this year. And the first draft, it public comment, teacher comment. And then we got to read all those, and then I don't get to write, but I get to read them, and then write what the authors, what the revisions are. Long story short, it's back in committee. After the second revision, it went back into committee on August, 26th. And so now they're rewriting the California framework. And the goal is for it to be out in November, so you should see it, the first of the year is likely when it, maybe December. So that's, if you haven't seen the California framework, I strongly encourage you, if you teach in high school at all, to read through the framework. It's a very interesting document. And we have two people up here, too, in a little bit. It's going to kind of be a panel. I'm just going to review a little bit about NGSS, and then what the two workshops Dave has done, the two workshops we've done in May, and then again in August, so you have some context. And then we have people who are going to just answer questions about NGSS and have you guys share as well. So you guys want to at least say hi and just how we're going to roll.
Hi, I'm Michelle Kiefer. You already heard from me. I teach at San Marino High School in Novato, and I have been on our science leadership team for the past 3 years working to help our school site transition to NGSS.
And my name is Jason Nicholson, and I teach at Monterey High School, and I teach chemistry and biotechnology, and yeah. And we've developed a 2-year program over the last 3 years.
So they're going to be up in a couple minutes, and we're just going to have some discussions. Somebody asked how many people have taught more than 2 years. So how many of you have taught fewer than 2 years? Yay! All right. Well, welcome, then. You're kind of coming into a really cool time with NGSS. I'm taking it out. This is my 33rd year. I've been in the classroom the entire time. So I've taught anatomy, physiology, honors anatomy, bio, AP bio, physical science, and I'm out this year for the very first year with no kids. And after we started school late, so we've been in school 9 days. So I've had 9 days of being a coordinator working with adults. And I had 33 years working with kids. And it's only been a small sample size of 9 days, but so far, kids are way more fun. If you're ever thinking about that transition, so some of the opportunities, just briefly, if you are a young teacher, and I just want to, part of learning about NGSS is availing yourself to what's out there. If you are a pre-service teacher or a first-year teacher and are interested in a program that supports teachers in learning how to teach science effectively, it's a $125,000 opportunity for you. You can come see me right after this. It's only for first-year or pre-service teachers in high school math and science. Also, if you're looking for additional resources for biotechnology or aligned with NGSS, some of you are, how many of you are familiar with HHMI? Good. How many of you actually use HHMI? Right now, currently? Outstanding. So I'm write curriculum for them, we'll go to the Holly lectures, and then we listen to the guys do their deals, and then we write the curriculum that you all use. If you haven't used HHMI lately, they have a wonderful section on biotechnology. So think about doing that. Also, if you are looking to link information around from your classroom to other groups in the Bay Area who are doing similar work, the California Institute of Biodiversity is a tremendous resource. I'm on the board of directors there, and we link high schools from all over California where kids do common research and then kind of put it in a database. It's kind of cool. And then please consider joining, if you're not a member, CSTA or NSTA, or attending one of our conferences so you can learn more. We were at the rollout. Alameda County did their rollout with Wednesday and Thursday, right? And we're stunned. We were just talking about this. How many people, how many teachers still don't know like exactly about NGSS? Like, I think one of the S's is like stands for science. And that's not what we need, where we need to be at right now. So availing yourself to those opportunities. CSTA is in Palm Springs this year, and NSTA National Conference is in Anaheim. So a lot of school districts won't send you out of state, but they'll send you in state. And that's in the spring, it's the last week of March, first week of April. So I encourage you to just kind of be parts of those organizations. So we lost a little bit of time, so we're gonna pick up the pace. That's kind of the agenda for today. I don't know that we're gonna get additional resources. Those are primarily HHMI things. I'm happy to meet with you afterwards, or you can email me, I can still do that stuff. We're just gonna kind of flip through that. I apologize, we did lose some time. So a little bit about NGSS. So we heard earlier today about the 1998 standards. So they came out of some of these documents that are have been around for a little bit. Some of you guys who talked for a while, you remember the AAAS, that giant book that you had no place ever to, one person. Anybody else remember that spiral-bound giant book that didn't fit anywhere and had the maps? And that was kind of the course guidelines for what kind of they thought they would do. From that came the framework for K-12 science education. And this book was referenced earlier today. If you aren't familiar with this book, this is probably the book that makes NGSS the most different from any standards that we've ever had. This is a research around how kids learn. So the 1998 standards was kids will describe, kids will list, kids will know. But not how will they come to know these things. How will they come to be able to describe? They were just what they were supposed to be able to do. We had those crappy textbooks. Most of you, or many of you, are probably in the school. We are. The Williams Act requires our kids to have textbooks. So we dutifully march them down in the book room when they check out their textbook. You know, we say, don't lose it. You're going to turn it in June, and you're hardly ever going to, you know, bring it to class. Right? That's what we're at. Our biology book has a chapter that says, when the Human Genome Project is complete, they will be able to. Oh my gosh, that's the book we're checking out to our kids. Soviet Union. Oh my gosh. So, and then the state of California says don't buy any textbooks till 1919 is what the recommendation is. They're funding no textbook purchasing till 1918-1919. So, what the heck are we supposed to do? Well, from that came the next generation science standards. So, it is the content that the first speaker talked about. But the difference is how students are to learn the content, and that is real different. So if you've been teaching for a while, you know that, oh my gosh, I've kind of always taught this stuff, but not in this way. And that's what kind of makes it unique. So, three dimensions of the NGSS. There are eight science and engineering practices. Does anybody know what the eight are? At a group like this, we should be able to get all eight. Now, wait, I know, I have a handout. You're worse than the kids. I didn't Google it. Without looking at your handout. What are the eight SAPs?
Using evidence.
Okay, modeling.
Asking questions.
Analyzing.
Explanation.
Using math.
All right, so we're kind of getting it. So if you flip it over, you have it. Those are the eight science and engineering practices. And the eight science and engineering practices are how kids engage with the content. I should say how kids engage with the concepts, because the SEP, the science and engineering practices, are content as well. We have to remove this idea that the content is the facts. The content is the practices, it's the concepts, and it's the cross-cutting concepts that catch them all together. It's not just DNA, that's not the content. It's the practice that the kids engage with to learn DNA, and it's how DNA connects with other things. So that's really important. So there are 8 science engineering practices. There are 7 cross-cutting concepts. We're not going to have you say them because you all could read them. And the difference between the science and engineering practices and the cross-cutting concepts is the science and engineering practices is how kids engage with the content. The cross-cutting concepts are what connects that content to other things, not only throughout your year, but throughout their entire TK-12 science experience. So in the area I teach in, and probably some of you, it's a little transient at times, so we don't necessarily have the same kids stay in our school district TK-12. I grew up in Belmont, went to Carmel High School right down the road, and most of my friends were the whole time. But where I teach at, that's something not true. So the idea is that if a kid comes into your classroom in 8th grade, or you're not middle school, but say in 10th grade, they had the same standards no matter where they came from in 4th grade and 7th grade, and that would be, that's the ideal goal through this. And the cross-cutting concepts bring them together. And then there's the disciplinary core ideas. There are 44 of those. And this is the 3 dimensions of the NGSS. The DCIs, the disciplinary core ideas, are broken down into physical, life, earth and space, and engineering. So that's the gist of the NGSS. On a thumbs up, or let's say a 1, 2, and 3, for a 3, like you barely are comfortable using this. Not I just know the SEP is modeling, but that you actually engage in modeling in your classroom. On a scale of 1, 2, or 3, how comfortable are most of you with using these practices in your classroom? 3 means I use them all the time. 1 means I'm not so sure. So I'm just giving you a sense of how quickly kind of move through the beginning. 2, 3, outstanding. That's pretty cool. And they work together to form what are called performance expectations. 1998 says students will list. NGSS says students will be able to argue from evidence. Students will be able to model. Students would be able to ask a question and then design a solution, right? So asking questions is great, but solve the problem. Like, your kids are pretty good at identifying problems.
I don't have a notebook.
Well, solve it. Get a problem or something, you know what I mean? So that asks them to solve those problems. And so teaching three-dimensionally is what the NGSS is all about. So those are the practices, and those are DCIs. The performance expectations, there are 72 of them, and they are designed to be taught TK through 12, and they are what students will know at the end of instruction. So when a kid gets out of your school district, that's what they should know.
They're broken up into these domains. Physical science is broken up into physics and chemistry. That's where the 2 subjects are separated there. All right, there's a timeline. We adopted the NGSS in 2013, California did. Okay, so it's a little stunning, actually, at this point, that so many people really don't know very much about the NGSS, if you're in the classroom teaching. It's been, you know, I realize you're PD sometime at your district. I mean, I've been at some district PDs, and like, they're awful. Like, if you didn't have papers to grade, you wouldn't be like, why even go? So the idea that we're trying to get better PD to get teachers better equipped to deal with the NGSS. But it's been around since 2013. This that began the awareness phase. The CSTs were given here and here, but of course they didn't count, so it's kind of silly. We are moving out of the awareness phase, so everybody ideally should have been aware of the NGSS and how to implement it, not just be aware of the name. And then we begin the transition phase, where you should be now transitioning your lessons and units of 3 dimensions. Now I've heard like biotech and anatomy, physiology, marine biology. I have a colleague that I work with through KSPF, and she teaches marine biology, and she said that she was told that, you know, well marine biology doesn't really have to worry about NGSS because it's not biology, chemistry, or physics. And that's simply just not true. Biotech should, all that stuff should be NGSS aligned. And then the kind of a new thing that some people may not be aware of is that we were supposed to give the CSTs, which this was supposed to be the last year, in March of 2017, and that is no longer true. Now, every student in 5th and 8th and 10th grade, well, maybe not in high school, but every student in 5th and 8th and some high school students will take an NGSS exam this March. So there are some teachers who are, there are some school districts that have been going, oh, wait till the test. Great, the test is here. Okay, let's get going. So there, so as of right now, and I'll explain it in a second, and jump in, because you heard the same thing I heard this week, is that this year, everybody's going to be taking the test. It won't count. It's really for test development. Next year, everybody takes the test again. And then it becomes fully operational and reported out for school accountability in 2018-2019.
And just to clarify, that's going to be an electronic basis.
Yes, yes, yeah.
And it will be up to your school district what grades at the high school level that test will be administered.
Correct.
And it can be administered until the very last day of school.
Yeah, I have the window open. Question?
So the first year, this year, select 10th grade or any grade?
No, it's going to be any grade.
And then next year, all 10th grade or still select schools?
That's a good question. And probably won't be 10th grade. So the CSTs were 10th grade.
Yeah.
It'll be your district's decision what grade to put this test.
Thank you.
That test will cover all of the standards. So if they get it in 10th grade, they're supposedly being tested on physical science, life science, and earth science.
Correct.
And chemistry.
And chemistry.
Correct. Well, physical science.
Correct.
Yes.
It's more of the state
network.
Does this go
with computer adaptive or computer assisted?
So does everybody know the difference between computer adaptive and computer assisted?
Last I heard, it was still in discussion.
Yeah, last I heard on Thursday was that it was going to be assisted, but I don't know. I don't know. So right now,
what accommodations do they have for special ed kids who have reading issues?
Yeah. So I know some of that, and my concern, and I'm really concerned because there's somebody who can stay here. That I don't know enough about the testing. Like that's not part of my knowledge base other than what I just learned at a trainer's meeting a couple weeks ago. So I know a little bit, but I don't know enough. Like I know enough just to get this right, so I don't want to screw this up. The way it's going to work as of right now is that the assessment each task, it will be computer based. Some of you guys are old enough to remember, experienced enough to remember the Golden State exams. How great were the Golden State exams, right? They were great to give. Kids loved them, and we got to keep the dropper bottles. And so the idea is that the computer will be somewhat similar, where the kids are going to be doing things. So if the performance expectation says students will model, blah, 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 then on the assessment, they will model. If they're not going to bubble in, they're not going to like give a multiple choice test. There may be a portion, but if the PE says they will argue from evidence, then they're going to have to type in an argument from evidence. So you have to have your kids doing the things that the PE's performance expectation says that they will do. And each task will cover a minimum of two of the dimensions. So somebody earlier had said, well, boy, there's a lot of content. The science and engineering practices are content. So if your kids can't do the SEPs but know the content, they're going to struggle with the test. If they can't model, if they have no idea, if they think Jell-O molds are models, they're going to have a hard time with this. Okay? If they don't understand how to look for patterns or cause and effect relationships or understand stability and change, which are all fundamental concepts, they're going to struggle with that. All you think are being taught are content through the concepts and the DCIs you have there. It's very struggle. Any questions on that? Cool. All right. So the test is 5th, 8th, like you said, 5th, 8th, or 10, 11, 12. It'll be up to your district.
So I'm sorry, I actually have a question for the previous thing. So the performance expectations, as written, with whatever verb is in the beginning, I'm just going back to what Bruce
right
was saying. So
that arbitrarily chosen verb, we should make sure kids are doing the performance expectations as written because they'll be assessed that way?
I would say that no. I mean, I don't know how arbitrary it was that they were selected. However, as teachers and as we know our context with our kids, if we think that this content is better served in our context by arguing from evidence, then argue from evidence and model something else. There's not going to, I don't think it's necessarily important that they, if the PE says modeling, that they model. I think you have to do modeling. I don't think it has to be for that particular context.
Okay, but just to clarify, on the assessment, they'll be asked to do that skill with that particular
content. But you know, if it says argue from evidence, what are you going to argue from? Well, it may very well be the model, right? So modeling takes up 24% of the PEs involved modeling, the highest number by far. So if it says argue from evidence, you might want to model first, but I wouldn't, I'm not teaching people to get bogged down in that particular SEP for that VCL. Sorry about all the jargon. It's easier to say SEP than it is. The assessment is designed to be administered in 2 hours or less. That's for the average kid. So some kids are going to finish in an hour and 20 minutes, and some kid may go, longer. But that's the assessment that's designed for that average time span. It'll be divided into three segments. Segment A, it says adaptive segment, but I'm not exactly sure how that's going to work right now because it's going to cover a very broad range of the California PEs. So in fifth grade, it'll cover the fifth grade PEs, in eighth grade, the eighth grade PEs, but in high school, it can cover any of them. It'll cover the grade band. High school is always grade band. Okay. So your kids will be assessed on Earth and Space Science in March. So segment A. Segment B is a little more challenging for kids sometimes. It's a more complex situation. They're going to have to analyze and interpret data. They may have to drag and drop something to create a model. They may have to label from a list of things. If you've seen how the Common Core is administered, you get a sense of how that is all made look. And for right now, it says contributes to student and group scores. That is not true for the first 2 years. This is not going to be reported out on. This is for you. It's really for the test writers to create better test questions. So it's not, nobody's going to get a score. So you have time to play with curriculum. No admin, people say, why don't you go to admin? And I say, are you crazy? No admin should be evaluating you on your 1998 standards. They should be in your classroom seeing if your classroom is messy and loud, and are the kids trying to solve, answer phenomena and look for solutions. They shouldn't be in rows and desks listening to you like you're doing to me. Go on. As good teaching. Oh, we're a great classroom. Nobody said anything. I think we're all asleep. So they should be engaged in doing things. And so there's no testing that counts for a few years. So this is your time to figure stuff out. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. So, and then C, for both 5th, 8th, and high school will be grade span. I know there's no elementary folks in here, but this is where elementary gets a little tense because it'll hit the three to five grade span if you're in fifth grade. So if you're a fifth grade teacher, you've got to go over that. That's the way it works. So that's basically the gist of the assessment. For the California assessment pilot, so they're calling it a pilot. The pilot means like only some people take it. It's the traditional meaning of that word, I think, in testing, but not everybody's taking it. I don't know why they're calling it a pilot, actually. California will design the test questions. However, when the operational test becomes, they want you all to start designing test questions. They want test questions to be locally developed. So if I teach in Pacifica, I may have a different subset of questions because I'm near the ocean. Somebody said, I've never seen the ocean. I moved to Pacifica. I thought you could still live here and not see the ocean very often. But you may have a different set of questions than if you lived in Bakersfield, for example. And so they're going to ask teachers And there's a way for you all to be involved in writing of those questions. So the idea would be that the questions would be more local. So kids wouldn't take the exact same test in the state of California. So if you're interested in that, there's information at the end. Anything else, right? That's anything else on that? Okay, that's what I remember. Here's the only hiccup. The CDE, the California Department of Education, has applied to the federal government to not give the CSTs. We were hoping on Tuesday at the rollout that they would have said, we got the waiver. But the federal government, strangely enough, is slow in response. So we haven't heard any of it. But the governor has said, I'm willing to write the check right now. Apparently, I don't even know the number, but it's millions. Apparently it's cheaper to pay the fine than it is to administer the test. So somebody said that he's willing to pay the fine. So it's not official that we haven't got the waiver, but we're all going, right? We're all going like we're taking the test. So
is there an actual example that teachers could look at of what certain A, B, and C are going to look like as taken on a computer?
Yeah, so currently there's a couple things out there, not very much. Test release questions should be out in January. Of what they'll look like in A, B, and C.
17.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah,
I'm not sure if you make science in the NGSS.
Is there formative stuff? You got some of it.
Yeah, my understanding is that there's not a lot of release stuff out there. Yeah, because maybe this was just really decided just in March that we were going to move forward with this, or that they were going to move forward with this. I know January, right? January is when they're going to dump a bunch of stuff.
Next year.
Yeah, 2017. So you have a couple of months to look at it. You know, I don't know, maybe just because it's getting all stuff online could be the deal. Or the other thing could be perhaps like, The last thing that anybody wants people to do is for teachers to develop a test and then start designing for them. This test is not recorded online. We want you to design curriculum based upon the performance expectations. And if you haven't seen these, look up the evidence statements. I'm not going to have time to show you this, but evidence statements were released a few weeks ago. And every performance expectation now has an evidence statement that's attached to it. That's specific to that performance expectation. So if the performance expectation says students will ask questions and design solutions to do da-da-da-da, you can get the evidence statement that shows what it would look like in the classroom if kids were doing that. The caution is the evidence statement should be used at the end of your planning to ensure your planning was done correctly, not at the beginning of your planning as a rubric to do stuff. Plan your courses, create your conceptual flows, write your 5E lessons, and then look at the evidence statements. Don't look at the evidence statements first. But they're out there now, so that's kind of cool. All right, so that's the summary of the testing windows this year. Again, they're calling it a pilot test. I don't know why. Available testing window is going to be March 20th. And then you can give it to the last day of instruction. These dates, I'm sure, in these years are going to, they're up for negotiation, I'm sure, but they're going to be able to go later in the year, and so that's basically what we know so far.
Sorry, the difference between segment B and segment C, so segment C you said associated with grade span and measuring the performance expectations, so is that the DCI content by grade span?
Yeah, and it's not different for A, B, or C for high school, but it is different for elementary. So in elementary, they don't do grade span, I think, until segment C.
Okay, but for high school?
There's no difference.
All through segments?
Yeah.
So really, the difference is just the format of the questions?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, they're all grade span for high school. All right. So that's the test. That's all I know.
Wow. Just wanted to comment. I'm sure all of you have great ideas and you're already employing a lot of the practices. But the kids are going to be evaluated based on a computer test. So there needs to be some user-friendly software where teachers then can create a grade lesson, transfer it onto a computer so kids can practice taking that And now the teachers have a tool that they can use instead of the traditional whatever.
Right.
Say Scantron. Is that somewhere in place?
Oh, yeah. It's not, I mean, I'm not sure how much different. I'm sure it is. I haven't seen it. But a lot of us, I mean, about 10 years ago, when Scantron, do you guys remember Scantron tests? And if the machine broke, you were really screwed because you couldn't, you know, and if you put it through, the more noises it made, the worse the kids did. So I thought, like, Scantrons were going to make a comeback, so I hoarded. I got, like, 10,000 Scantron sheets. Nobody wants to buy any. But most of us have moved away. So we've been doing formative assessments and lab practicals and performance tasks for a while anyway. So you're right, being able to do that on a computer is certainly different. But most cases, it's not going to be the jump from a Scantron to a computer simulation. It's going to be a jump from a performance task that you give in the classroom anyway to a computer simulation. But it's still, kids still need practice with it, for sure.
Yeah, there's a nonprofit done by my school called Comfort Consortium, and they actually work with the Educational Testing Service, and they have these online modules that cover a series of EdGSS practices, and it helps the students go back and reevaluate their questions, and actually takes long answers and will grade it based on the quality of their logic, the content, how it relates to the individual question. And it's the same underlying software that they're going to use to develop these tests that actually does the scoring.
And what was the name?
Concord Consortium is the name of the nonprofit. High Adventure Science is the name of the website. The high school level ones, they have one on climate change and one on water right now that are full units with big chunks that could take up to scores.
So, yeah, Concord Consortium also, if you're interested, they also supply labs, and they're working on these sensors. Some of you guys use Vernier sensors, and they're kind of expensive. Concord Consortium has smaller disc-like sensors where they're actually collecting stuff on water and climate change, and they're a third of the price, and they're really well done. So you can, again, if you're interested, I can hook you up. With that, Jerry Valdez on the Central Valley Science Project is involved with the Concord Consortium.
It's called Concord.
Okay. Concord Consortium, yeah. Kristen wanted me to kind of take a look back. A few months ago, you did something with Kirk Brown. If you were there at that workshop, was that in May?
June.
And he took your the PGLOW app and he applied what is called the Think idea towards it. And so this is one idea that he came up with, was do the transformation first and then follow this sequence of ways in which to look at the PGLOW app. So if you were there, this should look familiar. I might want to review it for people who were there. And if you weren't, this is just kind of what the history of how Babeck is trying to NGSSize things. I think the difference, if you had to sum it up in a word or two, would be that NGSS doesn't start with us giving kids information. It starts with them doing activities before content and then figuring stuff out. So ABC, activity before content. Where I think before we just said, here's a lab with directions and do it. And so this was Kirk's, who's amazing. Kirk Brown is out of the San Joaquin Office of Education. Incredible guy. Here's what he came up with. He introduced you then to the 5E model. How many of you are familiar with the 5E model? And so the 5E model is a learning cycle sequence in which you create your lessons. There are others, and if you have one that works for you that's not 5E, use it. Some of you may be familiar with UBD, Understanding by Design. 5E is a little bit easier. People think it's new. It cracks me up, right? Because we're using it again. It was developed by BSCS like 30 years ago. The first E is engage. Engage is not a hook. It isn't like this cool thing. Engage is phenomena that you use for the entire unit for kids to explain. That's what they're doing the entire unit. If you are going to be at Rollout 4 next year for California NGSS, I'm on the writing committee for that right now, and we're doing a whole segment on phenomena. Rollout 4 will focus around two issues, phenomena and assessment. So Rollout 3 was modeling and 2 of E, so that's pretty cool. So the first E is engage. The second E is, anybody know what the second E?
Explore.
Explain.
Explore.
elaborate or examine and then evaluate. And you don't follow that. It doesn't go like boom, boom, boom. It's engage, explore, explain, explore, explain, explore, explain, engage, explore, explain, elaborate. So it does it. It's not sequential. It's a great way to think about planning lessons, and that's the model the NTSS uses. So in our district, we've taken, some of our subgroups of teachers have taken their content, created this really cool conceptual flow, made 5Es, plugged it into storylines, and we're running with it. And that's kind of where we're at. And then at the workshop in August, just a few weeks ago, we took the Pico lab and we said, how can each SEP be utilized in that lab? And we had teachers do the work. It was amazing. It was incredible how many, all the SEPs can be done in the Pico lab. We identified the DCIs that the Pico lab hit, and then we found that every single cross-cutting concept could be illustrated to the Pico lab. And that work is available. I saw the handout, an email, but I don't see it here.
Yeah, it's everybody has one.
Oh my gosh. Because my new glasses are super. Okay, so this is incredible. This is a don't like go to a workshop, put it in your folder, and then never take this one out again. This is a great document. This represents a snippet of some of the work that was done. This is certainly we could add more. We could make the font even smaller. We could add more. This is really good.
Christian worked really hard to get it to fit on two pages. Yeah. The front page basically summarizes the work that was done in the two workshops in kind of little snippets, take it home kind of language. And then our jigsaw on that.
This is really good. So if you're looking, think about biotech, and particularly if you don't teach biotech, if you also teach biology, and you want your kids to do this in your biology class, here's a bunch of ways to have the kids engage with that. And then what we're looking forward to in our upcoming workshops is how else can you build on this lab or other biotech labs? We're going to take a 5E lesson plan and create storylines for it, which has been asked of the NGSS. A storyline basically is when you teach something, what's the most logical question a kid's going to ask next? And if it doesn't make sense, then change the concept. Because it should flow to the next, and the next, and the next. If your concepts are unconnected, then it's hard for kids to follow. And then we're going to work at ways in which to look at differentiation within instruction and how to evaluate things. There was a question I skipped over a little fast, which was about sped kids. There will be part of the California Science Assessment Test. There will be a separate section. I forget the NMAP. I forget the acronym for that. But it's a separate section for students who have trouble manipulating computers or like need larger screens. There's all a separate section for them. Yeah. That's what we got coming forward. We were supposed to have an hour and a half for this session, and I want to make sure we have time for questions. So. What we were going to do in our next workshop is take the part of the Pico lab and identify the content, the concepts that could be taught at all different areas of biology, chemistry. This could be done in a chemistry class. You could bundle the performance expectations so this could be done in a chemistry class. So, and that's what we're going to start doing next. So, at this point, we have two folks who are implementing NGSS in their classroom. Both through biotech and their regular classes. So they're supposed to come sit in these big chairs and answer any of your questions or any of your thoughts. We're just going to start with just a general question, which is when you hear NGSS, what comes to your mind? So yeah. We'll get to guest share and then just get audience participation.
So what comes to my mind is students asking questions and seeking answers to those questions. So instead of kind of setting up the questions for them, actually having the students come up with the questions themselves.
For me, it's three things. One is, so as a former scientist, when I first saw that, the new standards, yes, students are going to be doing stuff instead of knowing stuff. That's a huge shift for me. The second thing is that the performance expectations, when I look at the performance expectations, and when I found out NGSS was coming and I had to write some new courses,
I use the performance expectations to drive the curriculum, because if you know the students are going to have to be able to do something, then it's really easy to say, okay, what do I have to have my students do in the classroom so that they can do this stuff for the assessment? And the third thing I like is that it's based on, it's phenomenon-driven, and some kind of observable phenomenon that's local. So for example, for the PLO lab, you know, you can say, we're going to make glow-in-the-dark bacteria. That might make some kids excited. You might say, like in an AP class, well, we're going to learn about transcription and translation and gene expression by, you know, making glow-in-the-dark bacteria. Or we're going to genetically engineer bacteria to have a new characteristic. But what's more engaging for the students is to, so I'm in Marin County, to show some images of, for example, when you go down Chamalas Bay at night kayaking, there's bioluminescent algae everywhere, or some kind of microorganism. I'm not sure, actually, the bacteria or algae. I think they're algae. But it's local and it's observable, and the kids are like, cool, and that's right here off our coast. And you can use that as kind of a springboard then to engage them in why, you know, why that might be important, and to kind of encourage them to try and explain why that happens.
When you guys hear NGSS, what do you think? What are your biggest worries? What like, oh my gosh, really?
Well, you're gonna have an issue that they haven't been trained somebody for the last 10+ years. And you're walking in your classroom, you know, I was in one meeting. Sacramento, they said, look, you can just assume that everybody below you taught their responses. You might help. That doesn't matter. And we're going to build on it. We're not going to do the interplasmic particulate because they already have that.
So the first few years, we got a problem.
The first time. But I will say that we are middle school. Oh, my best slide was next. I'm just teasing you. Our middle school teachers have been NGSSizing their curriculum the last 3 years, and this last pass, ninth graders that have been coming into my classes have been the best. They didn't know more science necessarily, they didn't know less, they didn't know more, but I could give them a task and they could figure out a way to get it done without me babysitting them, and that was a huge, huge difference. So, you're right. And middle school and elementary school have to do science.
A question or challenge that I have is thinking of where to find good phenomena, especially for biology.
Yes.
Because even that glowing bacteria, it's like, here, let me show you a bunch of pictures of glowing things, which is one thing, but I feel like in the physical sciences, there's so many awesome demonstrations, and I've been to a lot of PDs where it'll be a physical science-based phenomenon and then modeling activity, and so where do I get these awesome phenomena to like drive my unit?
It's so funny. We always used to use life science examples of as our phenomena because we felt like it was easier access for teachers. And then we got comments in the first two rollouts that, where's all the physical science stuff? So in rollout three, we used almost all physical science except for one little section of it. And the comments were, but where's all the life science stuff? So the NSTA has a phenomena bank that you can access. My district has a phenomena base that we're putting that you are welcome to email me, and I'm happy to share it with you. One thing we're doing is, I live in Alameda County, so the people who are responsible for NGSS implementation in Alameda County, so like some of the Fremont Unified, San Leandro, Dublin, San Ramon, and myself, we're going to collectively dump a bunch of phenomena on database. So, because looking for a phenomenon it takes forever. Because like you click on the internet, oh, this is good, I might do the better one. And then like 2 hours later. So, if you email me, put the email up, know if the screen's down. Again, you can email me, and I'm happy to share the link to our phenomenon. San Diego County Office of Education has an amazing, John Spiegel has an amazing database. Yeah, we need to stop having every district start like there's nothing out there. That was okay 2 years ago, so now okay.
I was just going to add that the Exploratory also has been collecting phenomena banks for like 30 years.
Yeah.
You can see it's kind of daunting, but it's very exciting at the same time. That there are, it really opens up so many possibilities. You just have to spend the time to narrow it down or decide upon which phenomena you want to go with. But, I don't know. I found it really exciting. At first it was like, well, what am I am I going to do? What is, what could my phenomena be for whatever you needed on here?
My biggest problem is that I have zero science experience as a field. I pick science because I love it and it makes logical sense. You can do a lot with it. But I have zero training on all this really cool stuff. So I have that level of like, where do I start and that? How do I get those skills so that I can then impart them to my students and then how do you get the materials that follow the skills? So I myself need more training.
Babeck is a great resource for that. And there are a number of labs, like the ALU lab, which I had never done myself, got training on how to do that lab. But yeah, going to events like that, training events where you can actually have the hands-on practice and make all the mistakes that your students are probably going to make. I think that's really useful.
One kind of nice thing about being in this transition period and that test not counting for a couple few years is you can get messy and make mistakes, and it's a pretty low-risk situation right now.
CSTA conferences, I'll run a short course there. It's a 3-hour course that you can sign up for, and we do a whole lesson. So we would do in NGSS world, a lesson is 6 to 8 hours-ish. When they talk about a lesson, it's 6 to 8 hours. It isn't what you do in 1 45-minute period. A storyline or an instructional segment can be 6 weeks. So we walk you through in a session with a lesson that might take you 3 weeks to do. We walk you through it in 3 hours. You get like a teacher hat, student hat. So at STA, CSTA, the California rollouts, you said somebody from your district. Make sure people from your districts who go back and teach you guys. That happens all the time, is you send somebody and then nothing ever happens. So those of you in San Mateo County, Santa Clara County Office of Education, their rollout is the first week of November. It's a Monday, Tuesday. Is it the 7th and the 8th or something like that? 7th and the 8th. So if you haven't been to a California rollout, an NGSS rollout, then that's where you learn all this stuff.
My perhaps biggest concern is time and schedule. Because if looking at the life science performance expectations and standards, etc., it's much larger than, physics and chemistry have spread between 2 years what we're supposed to be covering in 1 year, number of things. And, some of the NGSS practices are less content dense, shall we say, because if somebody stands up in front of the classroom and says, this is how this thing works, you can say, I checked off that thing, the kids have downloaded it, I've moved on to the next day. Whereas if it takes, here's something, figure out how it works, let me guide you, that works better at getting them to grasp it, but it's less content dense, shall we say. So I'm a little bit concerned, how can we deliver an education that gives them all the skills and their ability to solve problems, also touching on every single one of the performance expectations in sufficient time so that a kid can take the test in March, when I'm not done teaching yet, and he will do well or she will do well.
It's hard to get away from content and kind of being obsessed with content because that's what's been happening for the past almost 20 years. I try not to worry about it too much because it just kind of happens as you go through the performance expectations. So for example, a student has, I don't even know if this is one, but it would be similar one. A student will be able to use a model to explain how structure relates to function, okay? Nowhere in there do they have to know about an endoplasmic reticulum, how to spell it, what it does, but they need to understand, for example, that a cell membrane has holes in it that let some things through and some things don't, right? So like all of the time you would have spent teaching about the individual organelles, you don't really have to obsess on the content, you just kind of have to talk about or have them understand how the structure of these things relates to function. And you can use various models to teach them how to do that performance expectation.
So I think the hardest thing for us, for teachers, is to kind of step back and say, you know, do they need to know all of this content that they used to know in order to be able to do that performance expectation? Usually the answer is no.
Teaching students to be good problem solvers, I think, is more important than them knowing all the details of the content. And that's also something I think that NGSS is really focused on, is teaching problem solving and coming at problems from different perspectives to solve them. So.
And that's certainly a fair question. Mm-hmm. We get asked that question more so by chemistry teachers than any other content area. And I live in Pleasanton. I kind of get parents who look at test scores and that kind of thing. But the people who are writers of the framework, you know, were particle physicists. The lead writer of the framework was Helen Quinn from Stanford, who's a physicist. So these are people who know content, who feel that the content is totally sufficient, as we understand content is the practice and the cross-cutting concept.
But if they're, and I agree, my key focus is I want the kids to get how science works by the end of the year. And I had never really obsessed on, I have to hit all of these points. If I can get these points and get them solid, and the kids get the whole process, life is good. But I'm a little bit concerned that a particle physicist is writing the content or the performance expectations when most of those guys no longer remember what it's like to be operating a 16-year-old brain. It's still wiring itself, as opposed to the 45 or 55-year-old brain.
And that's totally fair. The part of the group, Maria Simani, who was referring to as the particle thing. She's in California. She's at UCR in the Department of Education right now. So she is involved with student teachers in the field, so she totally gets that.
Mm-hmm.
The content, there seems to be a question about the content everywhere we go.
Yeah.
And so,
would the adaptive thing allow a kid who's demonstrating he's really strong in, say, ecology, instead of, would it adapt to see how far that depth goes, and therefore says, hey, that kid really gets ecology. Yeah, that teacher didn't cover the molecular bio stuff, and the kid doesn't know the relationship between restriction enzymes and other stuff. But boy, can that kid do that thing.
That's my understanding.
I retired in 2006. And I want to explain where I'm coming from. When I look at, you ask the question when you think of NGSS for me, and I look at this, and this is a tremendous amount of work that I personally would not recommend you spend too much time doing. And I know, and I'm going to be critical, so you can remove me from the premise if you want.
No, we're not going to vote you off the island.
I've gone to these workshops, and many of them sit down. What does it align to? L73.6. And I'm going, mentally, going, stop. Because I don't think that's the best use of teachers' time when time is of the essence. So to me, there is value in it. But I would not spend time figuring out, line this, line that, line that. Just show me the assessment. Once I see it, now I know what I need to do. That's to lower, I guess, people's stress level. I'm at all these workshops. Once I see the assessment, oh, now I know how to model everything. And I don't really need to do this alignment to the degree that some teachers are. And that's just my contribution.
Okay, yeah, just to be clear, that, thank you. Where did you retire from?
Pardon me?
What school, where did you retire?
Silver Creek High School in East Side.
Congratulations on your retirement.
How do you like it?
Pardon me?
How do you like your retirement?
I would recommend it to anyone.
So the back of that sheet is not, that's a brain dump of people who are just working on a Saturday. That isn't good nor bad. That is just a brain dump of how people were thinking that they could use the PGLOW lab as a way to access some of the stuff. So please don't look at that as this is a model anything. It's just 12 people at 2:30 on Saturday looking at the work.
I've been to all of the rollouts. We get different tools in each rollout, and each tool has helped me to kind of interact with and understand the standards. Like, doing all of that alignment was great when I first saw the standards, and I needed to be able to understand how they work together. Now that I am familiar with
using the standards, I wouldn't do that either. I would start with looking at what I already have, and then, you know, what do I already have that can address the new standards? So it's something that you might use at the beginning, but it's not something you're going to have to do forever for every single lesson that you do.
Has anybody been to Rollout 1, NGSS Rollout 1? Do you remember conceptual flow when you thought you should have bought stock in Post-it notes?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So,
that scared my whole district.
Exactly right. So the way to align an NGSS unit is for teachers to sit down and say, pick a content like cell function. What do students need to know about cells function? You write that down, one of the big ideas. What are the little ideas that lead to the understanding of the big ideas? You don't look at the framework. You write that down first. You as teachers decide what your kids need to know. Then you go back to what you think they need to know and see if that fits in the framework and where it might fit. And then you look and say, okay, this is important for them to know. What practices can I use to engage them in that so they can come to understand that? And that becomes your curriculum map. So you start with what you as teachers feel the kids need to know, not looking through the NGSS document first. You're all professionals. You all are science people. You know content. So what do kids need to know? Start there. And then go through it and see what fits it and how much work you need to do.
This document was kind of a proof of concept that we could look at a lab like this and think about it as teachers and then see how it would align with the NGSS.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right.
And it's also something maybe we could show to administrators if they question, why are you doing this? We're doing it because it's part of the standards. It's aligned with the standards.
You were talking about the structure-functional relationship. Now, it can be related to anything, right from a molecule of water, how does it support life, right to the structure of the femur, right?
Yes.
Now, we have our courses in different baskets. Part of the course, you're talking about the chemistry, you're talking about cell structure, you're talking about anatomy, etc. But that core concept is going to be used in multiple places, right?
Yep.
So you will be having all these multiple concepts, which we are going to use in multiple spots in our courses. That's the way you work?
Mm-hmm. Now, cause and effect is one of the cross-cutting concepts that you would try to hit down as often as you could in all of your content.
Can I just add something to that? Another thing I like about the NGSS is that the Common Core, math, and ELA standards are trying to teach the same thing to our students, critical thinking, arguing from evidence. And so our kids, in terms of how they're going to be learning differently, they're going to be learning differently, but in the same way, not only in science, but also in English and also in math. And they're going to have common experiences around arguing from evidence, communicating information, evaluating information, being critical thinkers.
Thank you. One thing that I do, I'm still an adjunct teacher at a college, but one thing I do is I look at an experiment and I spike it. And I'm sure some of you do this. So maybe you have your kids run through this experiment. It's very robust, it always works. Maybe next year you run the same experiment, but you keep some of your reagents and you specifically spike it where it is a one. And so some groups, it's not going to come up as a group is. And that, to me, I don't know all this terminology, but I guess that can be the engagement part. Because now the question is, why do these groups have a result and these groups don't? And I think that's kind of an efficient way to kind of bring together all this stuff fairly easy without having to reinvent the wheel. And that's obviously what happens in the real world anyway. Nothing works, right? The first time, the second time, or the third time. And to me, that's when things really start getting exciting for me, because that's when they bring out and have to figure out what went wrong and repeat the experiment. They go, what? You have to do this experiment over again? They said, yes, you do. And I think they remember that much. much better than a canned experiment where most of the students kind of know the answer already. It's engaging, it's fun, but it doesn't teach the real world and how it applies. Just a comment.
You're right. One of the things that we covered at the last rollout was, if you have stuff you'd like to do, let's pull it out and let's see, does it help kids understand this? Does it help them explore this? Or does it just help them confirm something you just lectured for 60 minutes? And if it's confirmational, it needs to be tweaked or tossed. We shouldn't be doing activities in labs with kids that simply confirm that the video they just watched or the lecture you just gave, right? And by the way, direct instruction shouldn't be dead. 15-year-olds cannot learn by discovering everything on their own. If you've ever coached a sport, if you just rolled out the ball and played, I would have loved to have scheduled your team when I was coaching because it wouldn't be very good. So direct instruction absolutely has a place. It's just probably not 60 minutes a day for 5 days a week. It's in chunks to clarify and move on. As far as the modeling goes, I will say this, for people who challenge like how depth of understanding you need to do this, we have teachers, when we do workshops, we ask teachers to design a completed model of a particular concept. The last one was light off two apples, a red apple and a green apple, and why you can see them. It's super hard. Teachers have a real hard time creating a really accurate representation, a model of a particular phenomenon. They spend, the three of us, we'd be going back and forth for an hour. We should have this. Oh, it should represent like this. No, it should, it's super hard. So the depth of understanding that these kids have, I mean, you talk for a while. Kids, you have any questions? No. And then you freaking grade their tests, and you go, why did they ask questions, you know? And so models and arguing from evidence and claim evidence reason are all ways that we never used to do. And to the extent that all kids had to demonstrate competency in that. That NGSS is clear, all standards for all kids. That means no more classes, there can't be no more those kids, right? There can't be classes where the kids who probably won't go to college go, and then your good kids go there. That was never okay. But it's absolutely not okay in NGSS. The life science, the physical science, the earth and space science, and the engineering standards are for all of your students, not just some of your students. So districts are being really creative in how they're making that happen, but it's a big part of NGSS. Other questions or comments? Yeah?
And I can just reiterate what Jim said about, for example, modeling, because our classes are very heterogeneous. And I think the nice thing about the modeling and explaining, and even if the kid, you know, sometimes, especially with the SPED student, they can't necessarily always get all of the vocabulary, the science vocabulary. But when they sit down with a model of whatever you give them to demonstrate their understanding, and they tell you in their own way, they get it. They don't attach all the science words for whatever learning disability they have, but they understand it. And I think that's what's the great thing about the modeling or the claim and reasoning is because they make the connection in their head to the concept that you're wanting to get at. It's relevant to them. They can tell you, they can model it, they can demonstrate it, they can explain it. They're getting content, and they may not have all the words, but sometimes you're surprised they actually do get the words. You introduce the vocabulary as the kids are doing it, and it kind of starts sticking, because they go, what do you call that? Why do you call it that? You know, who made up that word? Why do scientists make such complicated words? But eventually it kind of starts sticking to them. And I think that's what I've seen change over the last few years, is that it makes my kids who have learning disabilities or my EO kids who can't, you know, who aren't as fluent in English yet, they're still able to show you and demonstrate they do understand what we're doing in class. And they're comfortable doing it because no one, everybody, they get to do it their way, not one way to do it.
Mark, as a retired teacher.
Mark, you used to run forensics workshops, right?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
Really good, by the way. Thank you.
Since you mentioned it, I just co-authored a book that my former district has done.
Yeah, so.
Very NGSS.
Yeah, so a couple of minutes ago, I just remembered that. I made the connection. So Mark does a great deal of work around forensic science, and his textbooks, I've used his textbooks. We actually used one of your early versions of your textbook in our algebra class to get kids, because strangely enough, we have a couple of kids who don't get algebra. And so we thought we would have to access it a different way, and we took a quarter of our algebra class that was built around one of your forensics units, so it was really good. A lot of your work that I used in the past, it was written before the framework came out, the original stuff that I have, but it would align easily with NGSX. So I think the work you have done is aligned with the notion of what NGSX wants kids to do. Don't give them answers. Have them ask questions and then design solutions.
My comment about modeling as a teacher, I'm trying to understand this whole emulsion PCR, barcoding, bioinformatics, and so I literally am at home. I go to and it really helps me before I attempt to explain new technology. So I'm sitting there with these styrofoam balls and strings and everything else because it's hard to understand this new technology. And so it's helping me as a teacher explain it. So just a recommendation for you. And it's fun.
I enjoy it. We have somebody in here who can speak to something called grab egg modeling. I'm going to put you on the spot. I'm sorry. That was too perfect of a setup.
Well, after attending the last BABIC thing with Jim, and he showed us his grab bags, I think I saw a grab bag in my back here, with a lot of random materials, and we practiced the activity there. I felt really inspired. So I went out, I blew $60 at the dollar store, another $20 at Michael's, and now I've got a drawer full of stuff in my classroom. I was missing an activity. I mean, this is not good teaching, but I realized that I was going to teach my kids about ATP, and I didn't really have an engaging way to present that. So I let's try the modeling thing. So I threw random things from my classroom, beans and yarn and post-it notes and paper cups, and we talked about ATP. I showed them a quick, 1 minute video on how ATP synthase works. I said, okay, now go and with your team construct a model that works and show me how ATP synthase works. And they're like, oh my God, that's crazy. But then as soon as they sat down with this stuff and started talking to each other and figuring out what could represent what and how that would show how things worked, it was amazing what they came up with. And this was, just a total crap show at first run at this. And I said, and as an extension, if you guys are really feeling ambitious, then create an animation showing how it works. And I said, how do we do that? I said, I don't know, you're the kids, you have the iPhones, you know how to work them. A challenge. And so sure enough, I started getting these great animations from them. And some guys never quite got there, some of them did, but it was really evident the learning was taking place. And then, at the end of the bell rang, and some people had half-made models, some made animations. Said, okay, to be continued. Next class, hey, let's take what we did that first time, let's try it again and see what we come up with. Also, the production value started going way up, and their understanding of how to put things together had grown exponentially. And we're like, whoa, okay, this is really eye-opening how much they got out of this. And so now we're designing kind of an assessment for the unit that where they're going to get choices of systems that they can try to portray into kind of animation.
Very cool. Thank you.
So thank you very much.
Anybody else? Questions or last comments? There's got to be. NGSS is scary. And some of you guys have 2-year science graduation requirements. And the California framework lists 2 options. What were the 2 options? 3-year or? 4-year, yeah. So no 2-year model even.
Yeah.
So
scaring the heck out of us.
Yeah. So what are you guys? How are you? Yeah. What are you gonna do?
We're in limbo at this point, the whole district is.
Just something we have been talking about in our district, because we do require 2 years, but it's still four classes, technically. And people take biotech, they take forensics, they take all these anatomy. What do? They say, oh, make them all NGSS, and that's absolutely correct. But in the practices, content doesn't matter. If they learn how to do it, they're going to be successful and stop focusing on what the actual content is. Because they're going to learn anyway, or they're going to be able to apply the knowledge. And that's the best I can offer to people. And because people get, oh my gosh, I don't know what to do. It's all about teaching how to teach.
Yeah, and it's not so much the content, right? We don't mean the content doesn't matter. I mean, we don't mean like, just, you know, sing songs and then model what you learn. But that's not the, because content is the practices and the cross-cutting concepts all molded together. So that's an important piece. Anybody else about the two-year deal or the California framework or workshops or how you can learn more or frustrations? If you have frustrations, I'll give you.
Is the new iteration of PIVO going to be available soon?
That may not be up to me. I think we're still working on it too, right?
We're still working on it. We don't have ideas. At this point, our thought is that we're going to do something that's sort of an a la carte sort of menu, so you can choose the type of phenomenon and the types of things that work for you rather than giving one set lesson plan. Because everyone does teach differently, and we want to be able to provide you with ways to approach this. So it is a little more.
Because the one slide showed you the transformation and then discuss and such and then experiment. And just thinking logistically, trying to fit that in my particular school's calendar, already things get kind of tight. It is in connection with the other people going to increase the amount of time that the schools have access to the.
I don't know if right now we have the ability to do that because we're limited in the number of kids we currently have.
Yeah.
But we will think about that when it comes time to think about how to further schools. We have 5 full portable labs now and the one mini kit. And I think all of the kits are out for most of the year, with the exception of one kit is only out one semester.
If anybody wants, I'd be happy to share our phenomena database with you. My email, this is exactly why I don't write on the board. It's jclark@slz.usd.org. And I'm happy to share the link to our website. Like I say, San Diego County Office of Ed has one as well. NSTA has one as well. Don't spend a ton of time doing what's already out there. I also go around to many districts and do PD. I've done them, Campbell Unified, I've done all their PD, and Dublin, I've done some stuff out in Dublin, and Sarah Mellon and Heritage and stuff. So please, I'm happy to help and give you whatever resources that you possibly can. I know that they don't want anybody to leave yet. I just one more comment, right? There's stuff. Yes?
I think we were just letting people
just rolling
know.
Out.
From here, I don't think there was any federal call discussing any closure statement.
Okay. All right.
So as the main person in the room, I want to thank all of you again for coming, and we enjoy being able to host you today, and awesome things for you. We're really looking forward to interacting with all of you this year. And on behalf of myself and Ying Su and Keegan, please get in touch and let us know how we can help to support you in the classroom. Please let us know what you need so you can do that technology.